So I'm just going to get right into it. First of all, I just want to welcome you all here to Trinity United Methodist Church here in Denton. We're excited that we're able to not only broadcast live our worship services, but to meet in person. Tonight, our youth will be meeting from 5 to 6, and actually, that is going to be a meeting about UM Army. So it's not just for our youth, but for anybody who is interested in going to and doing and participating in UM Army this summer, which is the week of Father's Day. I think June 20th it starts. So if you're already signed up or if you're interested in going with us and you'd like more information, I would invite you to come. Part of what they're going to be discussing are the new COVID protocols. So even if you've done it a million times and it's all been just like clockwork, it won't be this year. So I would encourage you to come to that. Wednesday night, we have confirmation from 5 o'clock to 6:30. It will be our last confirmation class. We have five confirmants will be confirmed next Sunday. We will be having worship outside to allow all of those families to fully participate. And Macy's one of our confirmants who's here with us this morning. And so it's going to be a great day when we have these young people choose on their own to be Christian and to follow the Christian faith. So that's going to be a great day in the life of our church. Saturday, May 1st, I'm sure you all know this, is World Labyrinth Day. And so all across the world, people are making an effort to make use of labyrinths, which we actually have one on our property. So there we will be holding, as part of a wave of peace labyrinth walk across the country, we'll be joining at 1 o'clock, and we'll have someone who will lead us in the labyrinth walk. That's on Saturday. So if you're interested, if you've never walked a labyrinth, it's an interesting experience. The things that go through your mind. At one of the churches I was at, we built one out of mulch for Lent, and we took our children out and let them walk the labyrinth, and then we asked them, what were some of the things that came to mind? And the ones I remember was one of them said, when I reached the point where I thought I was the farthest away from the middle, which is where they were going, I was actually the closest. And somebody else said, I kept looking at other people and thinking they were behind me. And then I realized that they were actually in front of me. So there are some really neat contemplative spiritual things and aspects of our faith that might be enlightening. So I would encourage you to do that. One of our youth members as an Eagle Scout project did that. So it would be a really good opportunity for you. Also, next Sunday, the He Leads Me Sunday School class, which is led by Herman Totten, who is sitting right there, is going to start back up. And I believe this class has not met for a year. Is that right, Herman?
Right.
So they have not done the Zoom Sunday School. This class is so excited. Yeah, never thought I'd see somebody so excited about Sunday School class, but they are so excited to be able to meet. They're going to be in the sanctuary at 10 o'clock. And I know others of you belong to Sunday School classes, and at whatever point you are ready to at least partially come inside and meet in person, let us know. With the pipes breaking at Lowry, and I mean, there's a shortage on construction materials. We are sharing space, so you may be in a room with little preschool things, but we will find a space for you if you'd like. So just let us know. And also, now Molly, is Molly's not here today? So Molly Cullum, I just want to let you know, if you haven't read my email, that she is going to be going to annual conference as a delegate at large. And so we're really excited to have a youth join us this year. So if you see her congratulate her on that. It's a great accomplishment for IVs. And lastly, I am fully protected by vaccine. Woo! So I know we're all in different places of comfort level, but my comfort level is I am willing to hug anybody who wants to hug me. So at the end of the service, for the first time in over a year, I am going to walk out during the postlude, and I will be at the back door, and I promise I will not push on you, but if you want to hug me, just come and hug me. I would totally love that. And that's all I have for announcements this morning.
If you will please stand, as I move my mouse up right here, and join me in singing the old rugged cross.
Amen. seated, and would the children join me up for the children's moment?
Don't leave me alone.
First, we celebrated his birthday. Remember, he was born and he was laid in a manger and wrapped in swaddling clothes, and angels sang. And then we talked about his journey to Jerusalem and that he had to die, but that God raised him back from the dead at Easter. So all of that we've been talking about for the last couple of weeks. And so the disciples, who kind of are following along on this journey with Jesus, were amazed, were kind of sad and confused and a little bit wondering if they even dare to believe that he was really alive again. And one of the things that they were trying to do was to figure out why all this happened. And because it seems like kind of a sad thing that Jesus would have to die, right? But God wanted him to be king, but not just a regular king. God wanted him to be the king of everything, the whole world and heaven and everything that came before and everything that's going to come after, that he would be the king of everything. And the disciples had no way of understanding that. So Jesus, in our story today, we will hear that Jesus begins to explain to them that all of this had to happen for God's will to be done. So sometimes things happen in our lives and we go, I don't understand why this is happening. This seems like kind of a sad thing. But sometimes the good things come out of it, and when we look back, we think, now I understand. Now I understand all the wonderful things that have come out of that. So I have two things for you. The first thing I have, and I have enough. Do any of you make cookies ever in your house?
Yeah.
Well, I hope you will now, because I have a cookie cutter for you that is shaped like a crown. And you can pass those on and each make one. And then when you make cookies, you can make them shaped like a crown. And remember that sometimes things happen that are kind of sad, but then later when we look back, we realize all of the good things that came out of it. Okay? And here is, this is a pin that Miss Denise left for you, and it says heart of worship. What do you think is the heart of worship? Jesus, that's absolutely right. So today we celebrate all the things about Jesus, okay? Can you bow your heads and pray with me? Dear God, thank you for Jesus.
Thank you for Jesus.
For being in our lives. And for making all things good. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Okay, thank you, kids, for coming up. You can go back to your seats.
Now we come to that time in a worship service where we offer our tithes and our gifts to the Lord that they might be used for his will in this place. And so I would ask that you would join me in prayer. Gracious and eternal God, you have given us so much more than we could ever imagine or even ask. You give us food on our table, a roof over our heads, And for all of these, we give you thanks. We are especially thankful for the gift of the presence of your Son, who is always with us through the power of the Holy Spirit. We ask that you would receive our tithes and our gifts this morning as an offering of thanksgiving for all of the many ways you have shown your love for us, especially this past year. We ask that you would add your blessing to these gifts, that they might be used in this place to draw others to you, that they might know the love that we have known. We ask all of these things in the name of your Son, Jesus, who is the Christ. Amen.
Join me in the singing of our doxology.
chapter 24, verses 44 through 49. And I would remind you that all of these things that I read today are things that happened on the same day that the women went to the tomb and found it empty, and that Jesus appeared to the people on their way to Emmaus, and now he is in the room with his disciples. Hear these words from the Gospel of Luke. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, the Psalms, must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." May God add a blessing to the reading of this holy word. Thanks be to God. Would you join me in a spirit of prayer? Almighty God, may the meditations of my heart and the sound of my voice be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So several weeks ago, we began a sermon series called Arise, Claiming Our Own Post-Pandemic Resurrection. And in doing this, we are following, actually, the journey of the disciples because their life drastically changed when Jesus was crucified and raised from the dead. For 3 years, they had followed him, been in his presence, sat at his feet, been taught by him, been lectured by him, and corrected by him. And during this transition time, Jesus was preparing them to receive the Holy Spirit, that they would take up that mantle that he would leave them and carry on the work of his church in the world. So as we begin to come out of pandemic mode, we are looking at the obstacles the disciples face, because I think a lot of them are ones that we ourselves are facing as we wonder if it's really coming to a close. So our first week, we looked at the story of Emmaus, when the disciples were walking along and talking to this man, and suddenly they realized it was Jesus, that he had been there all along, speaking into their heart as they went on this journey, wondering what was going to happen to them. And last week, we saw the beginning of this conversation of Jesus with his disciples, when it says, "And in their joy, they were unbelieving." Because I think that is a part of what we're feeling. As we begin to see things kind of come back to normal, we don't want to actually believe it because we're waiting for the other shoe to drop, for that kind of tablecloth to be pulled up, the rug pulled out from under us, or everything kind of collapse around us, because that has happened to us so much over the last year that we have a hard time, even though we're joyful, we kind of hold it in. And this week, we are looking at the process of looking back on things that have happened to uncover its purpose and its meaning. One of the things that really distinguishes human beings from other animals is that we are meaning makers. That's why we are storytellers. It's not to pass on the facts. It's to bring meaning out of events that happen, meaning out of our lives, to pass on the stories of our parents and grandparents to our children so that they can retain that meaning and that purpose for the lives of those people, the importance of the lives of those people. And animals don't do that. They operate on instinct, and they do have feelings. If any of you have dogs, you know. Animals can have feelings, but in the moment they have those feelings, they are not trying to make sense of them. Why did mommy go to work and leave me here for all this time? They just know I'm sad because mommy's gone. But people, on the other hand, we process things. We want to find out why, and not really why with information, but really why this deeper thing. And I think that all has to do with our connection to God, with our connection to the Creator, that there's a piece of us that knows that the one who created us, his ways are above ours, and we don't always know why things happen. So when my kids were little, and in fact, I think I only had the three boys at the time. I think the twins were, Mary Beth may have been a baby, but for those of you who don't know, I have six. So we had three right away, and actually we had four in 3 years, and then we had two a little bit later. But the twins I know were probably about three. And my brother-in-law and his wife came to visit, and they didn't have any children. And so we were out walking, and I'm pushing a stroller, and my three-year-olds are walking with us, and we're out for a walk, and it's in the fall, and there are leaves all over the place. We lived, I think, at the time in Wisconsin, so the leaves were beautiful and falling from the trees and piling up on the sidewalk. And one of the kids asked, why do the leaves fall? And so my sister-in-law began to explain, you know, photosynthesis and sap running and daylight getting shorter and temperatures changing, and she's talking, and finally they look at me and they say, Mom, why do the leaves fall? Because I learned that when they ask why, they don't want you to answer because. They don't want to know the reason. They want to know the purpose. They want to know, what does it have to do with me? What does all of this? And so I learned fairly early on that if they asked why and I said because, I would get done and then say why. And I'd say, well, because, and I'd answer the next question and then say, well, why? And the whys were unending because I never got to what they wanted to hear, which was the purpose. So I would answer so that. So they said, why do you believe so? And I said, so that you know, and bring them all in a big pile and jump in them. And they were happy with that. And that kind of is the way we are as people. We ask the question why, but when we get the information, it only serves to frustrate us. And you can even feel that when we ask the questions about why, from a context of political things that are happening, we ask why and get the answer. We ask, well, why? We continue to ask why, because deep down what we long for is the purpose and the meaning. And you know, we will never fully or even partially know God's purpose in the events of this last year and a half. But what we do know is God's ways are above our ways. And that Jesus said it is the Father's good will that all should be saved. And that the scripture tells us that one day every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So within God's purpose, we know that those are pieces of it. And we also know that God gave us free will. God gave us free will so that we could choose to love him, to follow him, to believe in him. That we could choose. Because your relationship is never equal if there isn't choice. And free will means sin. It means a broken world that we live in. And sometimes things happen because of the brokenness. And what we can look for in the midst of that is God's redemption. That things happen that are outside of God's will, but if we stand in the midst of it believing, we see this redemptive work. That God takes something that is really horrible and brings out of it good things that never would have happened if that event hadn't taken place. And there's a number of things in the midst of this. And this year, as someone reminded me today, you know, even if you removed the pandemic and all of the things that were tied to that, this has been a weird year. We have had lots of things, and right now our biggest obstacle as a congregation is that we have a building that we can't use because there's a shortage of supplies. The shortage of supplies partially is from the pandemic, because when people were in quarantine, they renovated their kitchens and bathrooms and all kinds of things, and the prices kept going up and up. But when that cold front went through and there was damage everywhere, it's like, it's not even that the prices are ridiculous, almost $100 for a sheet of plywood, but it's just not available. How do you get contractors to come and fix it if they can't guarantee they're ever going to even have the materials? So if you even eliminated the whole COVID thing, it's like, we have gone through this year when we have had to acknowledge that we have no control. But we have grace, and we have redemption. And God has created us to be people who make meaning. And so one of the things I will tell you, in my family is scattered all over. And at most, some of my kids I only see a couple times a year. This year's been worse. I have a granddaughter who is 14 months old, and the last time I saw her, she's 7 days old. Uh-huh. I have a granddaughter who's 7 months old that I have not seen in person. And so this year's been different in that way. But we discovered Zoom. I mean, who would have thought? We had Zoom birthday parties, Zoom anniversary. We will continue to use Zoom. It just never occurred to us, even though we had Skype and we had FaceTime and we had these things, it never occurred to us that this is a way to gather together as a large group and have conversation and celebrate together. So there are some things, I think, that have come out of this time that we will hold on to for a long time. The technology, I think, is one of those. There are some things that we will... I'm guessing that at some point our church will have a mask burning celebration, and we'll all bring our masks and burn them and say, praise the Lord, we can look at each other in the face. So there will be things, I think, that we will not want to hold on to, but there will be other things that our lives will have been changed forever because of this. But for our church, this has given us an opportunity to actually be intentional about who we want to be as we come back together. And it's sort of, in a lot of ways, I keep thinking, it's sort of like you have this awful fire in your home and your whole kitchen is destroyed. And part of you thinks, oh, well, I'll get new appliances. But then as they're, you know, you're looking at this empty kitchen, you think, well, I really always wanted the refrigerator over there, because why on earth did they put it there? And, you know, it'd be really nice to not have this whole wall, but have it open. I mean, you have opportunity. You don't wish for your kitchen to start up well. I don't know. I've actually been in churches where they thought, we just need a lightning strike in the right place. Because their churches were so old and costly to fix. We do not want that here. We really want this freeze to happen. But it's given us this opportunity to actually be intentional, because most churches, who we were in 2019 was because every year we kind of pieced things together according to what was already there. So I'm going to give you an example. So, the United Methodist Church started out in the United States as always having one service. You can tell, because the first United Methodist Church of whatever town is always pretty large. And there are some pride in being first. When I was in Broughton, they called themselves First Church. Not First United Methodist, but First Church. When I got to Pottsboro, it was a Baptist church, called themselves First Church, because they were the first church in the town. But as time went on, I mean, you can't afford to just every time, as the church grows, you can't afford to tear the building down and start all over. So they began to do what the Catholic Church did, which was to have multiple services. The difference is in the Catholic Church, it was always about the Eucharist. It was a commandment that they followed to come and do communion every Sunday, to come to church every Sunday. So it was less about fellowship. It was never about the preaching. That's why when you go to Catholic Church, it's called a homily, because they don't spend a lot of time working on being a good preacher. It's all about the sacrament of communion. So the more people, the more times you have people come in and out, and you can offer communion to a lot of people by having lots of services. But really, that was never a tradition in a Protestant church as much. That's why when you see Baptist churches, they just will tear it down and build a new sanctuary to fit everybody. But the Methodists, we began to have two services. In the South, 8:30 and 11. Up north, 8 and 10. It probably had to do with how dark things got so quickly up there. I don't know. But all of a sudden, in the 90s, that was my generation. That was when we were raising kids and started to have a voice in the church. We wanted contemporary music. Contemporary music and I don't know if I'd say most, but there were a lot of women who were still stay-at-home moms. So we were home with our kids all day long, and we wanted a 1 hour a week to be a grown-up, to go to a service where we could put our kids in Sunday school and worship like a grown-up. Perfect solution. 9:45. Service was born. It was, we called it contemporary, but it was, 70s and 80s kumbaya music, because that's what we liked. That it was the songs of our youth. And what ended up happening was we have a whole generation of parents who never went to Sunday school, who have kids who never worship with their families outside of Christmas and Easter, and who in their minds, church is about fellowship and learning. And so we, as United Methodists, and I don't know, there may be other denominations who did that, but it really is a mark of the Southern United Methodist Church. 8:30, 11 o'clock traditional, 9:45 contemporary, right in the middle of the Sunday school hour. But in some ways, our whole kitchen has burned down. We've had over a year where, sometimes all we had was what we had online, and it was pre-recorded, and it was the best we had available. But we've got new times coming, and we can actually think about what kind of worship we want. Today, this group of people, this generation of Trinity United Methodist Church people, do not have to be locked into what the people in the 80s and 90s wanted. And not just for worship, for ministry, for mission. The needs of the people of our community are different today than they were 30 years ago. The needs of our children and youth, the needs of our adults and our senior citizens, different than they were 30 years ago. So we have been given this opportunity to reimagine what we want Trinity United Methodist Church to look like and feel like. So probably a week and a half to 2 weeks from now, you will get an email with a very lengthy and detailed survey. And I would like you all to fill it out. I may be here 1 more year, I may be here 5 more years, but I guarantee at some point I will be gone and you will still be here. If I have one thing I would love, it would be for there to not be a worship service in the middle of a Sunday school hour. But this is your church. And I know that as time has gone by, you've thought, I wish. If only this thing were different. If only this thing were different. If only we had an opportunity to do this. This is our time. This is our time to let the Holy Spirit move and let us find the new thing that God wants us to be. And so this is what we're asking. You will get it and it will ask for your name and your phone number and a place at the end for you to sign it. Because I know some of you will let your spouse fill it out, but I want you to be able to read what your spouse has written and make sure that it is what you would say. We're going to ask you questions. If you could change one thing about the worship service you went to, what would it be? What service did you go to and why was it? Was it because of the time, because of the music, because of the style of worship? We want to try to do our best that we can offer worship that is what the congregation wants and needs. But also ministry, and also mission, and also education, and also spiritual life. So I hope that you will take the time to fill it out and give us your feedback. And this is what I promise. You will not be 100% happy with whatever it is on the end. Because we have like almost 500 members. But your voice will be heard. And if you say, I really wish that we had a walking group. This is what I wish. I wish we had a walking group that met at 7:30 in the morning to walk around this beautiful walking area. Well, if you put that, I'm going to call you and say, hey, would you like to have this up? So just be prepared and talk about your phone number. But the church is like the scripture. So I don't know how many of you read the scriptures a lot, but it's like you'll read something you've read 100 times before, and you'll see something totally new and different in it. It's because it is a living thing. The Word of God is a living thing. And it's in relationship with us. And the church is a living thing. And, you know, if I had my choice, I would not ask for this. You know, if I could go back and choose whether or not we had a pandemic, I would have said no. However, we have an opportunity to take advantage of this time, to rethink who we want to be and how we want to proclaim the goodness of the gospel in the world. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give thanks in all things. We give thanks for the things we do not understand, which right now is most things. But we trust you. We trust that you lead us. And we trust that you have not only done a work in our hearts and in our souls over this last year and a half, but that you have done a work in the world, and that there is something that you want us to be. And we ask that you would open our hearts to hear your voice, that you would speak through us, that your will might be done in this place. And we ask for all of this in the name of your Son, Jesus, in whom we believe and place our trust. Amen.
Amen.
And now we've come to the time of our worship service where we share Holy Communion. And if you haven't received a bread and juice, you can raise your hand and someone will bring it to you. But I would ask that you just wait till the end when we need it and drink it. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image, and you breathed into us the breath of when we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through the prophets. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. And by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and you made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, you promised to be with us always in the power of your word and the Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died.
Christ has risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and all these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now you may receive communion, the body of Christ broken for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. Gracious God, we give thanks that you choose to walk this journey with us and to be in relationship with us. We give thanks that you are there beside us even before we are aware of your presence, and that you never leave us. We ask that as we look back upon this past year, that we will be able to see that your mighty hand has been at work in the world around us, in and through and in spite of all of the things that have happened, bringing all things in line with your perfect will. We ask for all of these things in the name of your Son, Jesus, and now we pray together the words that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen.
Please stand and join me in singing our final hymn, Nothing But the Blood.
The fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all as you leave this place.